political earthquake is rumbling across the pond tonight that could have huge implications. British Prime Minister Theresa May's government is in crisis with key members of her cabinet resigning, walking out, including her influential foreign secretary, Boris Johnson, in rebuke of her strategy to carry out Brexit. It all comes practically on the eve of President Trump's visit there in a couple of days. Trace Gallagher is live in our West Coast newsroom with the very latest. Hi, Trace.
Hi, Martha. Boris Johnson is a very charismatic, very well-known politician who was the leader of the Brexit campaign to take Britain out of the European Union. But he was clearly at odds with Prime Minister Theresa May. In fact, a few days ago, Johnson said that May's plan to maintain close trade and regulatory ties with the EU was, pardon the quote, polishing a turd. Then yesterday, it appeared Johnson was willing to go along with the prime minister's plan until late last night when Brexit Secretary David Davis turned in his resignation, accusing Theresa May of giving too much away too easily. In his resignation letter today, Boris Johnson went even further, saying the Brexit dream is dying. Quoting here, what is even more disturbing is that this is our opening bid. It is as though we are sending our vanguard into battle with the white flags fluttering above them. Johnson and other Brexit supporters are wanting to make a clean break from the EU to strike new trade deals around the world. But the prime minister later defended her Brexit strategy. Watch.
Over that time, I've listened to every possible idea and every possible version of Brexit. Mr. Speaker, this is the right Brexit, leaving the European Union on the 29th of March 2019.
Prime Minister May tried to calm tensions by quickly naming Health Secretary Jeremy Hunt to replace Boris Johnson as Foreign Secretary. But opposition Labour leader Jeremy Corbyn said the government was incapable of delivering Brexit.
We have a crisis in government. Two Secretaries of State have resigned, and still we are no clearer on what future relationship with our nearest neighbours and biggest partners will look like.
Experts say the loss of two senior foreign ministers and the anger among the Brexit-supporting lawmakers leaves the prime minister in a tenuous position. They believe for her to avoid a no-confidence vote, she may have to abandon her current Brexit plan and take a much harder stance. Despite the turmoil, the White House says President Trump is looking forward to his meeting with the British prime minister. Mr. Trump arrives in Britain on Thursday. Martha.
Wow, they're going to have a lot to talk about. Trace, thank you very much. Joining me now, Nigel Farage, former leader of the UK Independence Party and a former member of the European Parliament, and now a Fox News contributor. Nigel, good to have you with us tonight.
Thank you.
My goodness, where is all of this headed?
Well, look, it's very simple. The British people had a referendum to decide on our future. We voted to leave the European Union, to leave its court, to leave its lawmaking processes, to take back control of our borders and our money. Simple. And yet, this Prime Minister, Theresa May, who incidentally was a Remain voter in the referendum, presented a plan at Chequers, the country house of the British Prime Minister, on Friday that basically said we would still stay part of many bits of the European Union, including the customs union, the lawmaking process, all of which would mean we were taking rules from elsewhere without having a say. It would prevent us probably from having a trade deal with America and other countries. And it was nothing less, Martha, than a total betrayal of what people had voted for in that referendum and a general election.
Now,
Boris Johnson kept quiet for 48 hours. I think he's now sensed where the wind is blowing, and by resigning, he's done the right thing.
All right, so where are the winds going? I mean, does Theresa May get pushed out, or does she come back closer to you and Boris Johnson? Do you, as you said on radio, get back in? Do you lead the UKIP party once again and try to become prime minister yourself?
Well, do you know something? I was a businessman. I got involved in politics because of this European question, because I wanted us to be an independent, free, self-governing, democratic nation. I fought for 25 years to get that referendum and the result we got. And if they're going to throw it out of the window, then I will be back fighting them with even more vigour than I had last time. I personally believe that the Prime Minister will be gone within the next fortnight. And then we have a chance to get a prime minister, a leader of the Conservative Party that holds faith with 17.4 million voters who voted Leave in what was the greatest democratic exercise in the history of my islands.
So you think there is the political will to push her out, to have a vote of no confidence in a fortnight? I mean, what happened? So then you've got President Trump coming in on Wednesday evening. He'll be there Thursday to meet with Theresa May, to meet with the Queen. What kind of UK is he going to be facing in a few days?
Well, President Trump, I think, will be very frustrated. He believes in Brexit. I know that. I've discussed it with him. Mm-hmm. He believes in the nation state, not these new globalist supranational outfits. And the president's going to be furious, isn't he, that Theresa May wants to tie us into something that would stop us having a proper trade deal between the US and the UK. My guess is that President Trump will say some quite tough things when he comes to the UK, and he'd be right to do so.
So if she is pushed out in a fortnight, as you say, who's going to replace her?
Well, Boris, of course, Johnson will always favour himself as being the man that gets there. There's an old saying in Conservative politics that the favourite rarely wins. There is an outside horse, somebody called Jacob Rees-Mogg, who to American viewers will appear like a sort of 18th century English country gentleman. He's very old-fashioned, he's very charming, but he's very genuine. And I would say between Boris and Jacob Rees-Mogg, one of those two will take the crown.
All right. I want to ask you a quick question, and I'm going to see you when we get to London shortly. This blimp that Sadiq Khan, the mayor of London, has approved to fly over your city while the president is there in protest, how do you feel about that?
It's an insult. You know, whatever Sadiq Khan thinks about President Trump, he should not put that personal enmity above the fact that President Trump, like him or not, is the leader of the biggest and most important country in the world. And I cannot imagine any other city in the world that would fly a blimp, you know, an insulting blimp of the president above their parliament on the day of his visit. Sadiq Khan is a total disgrace.
Let me ask you about the NATO meetings as well, because there's you know, concern that President Trump is basically sending the message that either you're in for the amount that you said you would be in for to all of these countries, and I think that, you know, most people understand that argument, you know, perhaps we pull out troops. There's a concern about that. Perhaps the United States doesn't keep its traditional role as part of NATO. And that dynamic changes. Would that send Germany into a position where they feel that they are the leadership militarily in Europe? What do you think about that?
This is the great untold story. Mm. NATO has been there since the late 1940s. It has been a great, successful military alliance. And, of course, the Americans have been very much the senior partner in all of this, with us playing a role as number two. We've now got to a position where out of 29 nations, only six of them are paying the basic membership fee of 2%. The rest, frankly, are taking America for a ride. And the president is right to call them on this. But there's another dynamic at work, which is this. The European Union now has pretensions for its own army, its own air force, its own navy. And the president of the European Commission, Jean-Claude Juncker, is telling the Germans and the French and everybody else they only need to pay 1% into defence, not the 2% that NATO demands. So, what happens at NATO is even more important than what happens in London. And I think Trump is right, and European citizens need to realise that America could walk away from guaranteeing their protection. It's time Europeans grew up and got real.
Well, we'll see if they're interested in a discount on national security in Europe. So, Nigel, thank you. We'll look forward to seeing you.
Thank you.